octogenarians. Why this is selected? Because the risk factors will be differing in the octogenarians. Octogenarians are the patients who are aged between 80 to 89 year old. So there is controversy. Most of the time, these cases will be treated with the endovascular treatment. But so we want to discuss the I'll be using two terminologies here. One is UCA. UCA is the unruptured cerebral aneurysms. And octogenarians. Octogenarians means it's patients between 80 to 89 years old. The global population is currently aging at an accelerating pace. In developing countries, more than 75% of the people die after 75 years of age. And in Japan, which has the longest life expectancy, female life expectancy was 86 years in 2007. So this is a life expectancy curve. Most of the Western countries like North America and Europe has already crossed the 80 years. But in India, the life expectancy is 68.3. The prevalence of UCA aneurysms is increasing in elderly patients in Japan. Elderly patients with UCAs, unruptured cerebral aneurysms, have some intrinsic difficulties, such as decreased life expectancy, increased presence of comorbid disease, increased surgical treatment risk, and poor prognosis for elderly patients with ruptured aneurysms. It was demonstrated that cumulative rates of rupture in the patients more than 8 years of the age were significantly higher than those patients between 70 to 79 years. In patients aged 8 years or older, aneurysms of 7 millimeter or larger and ICPC aneurysms were independent predictors of UCA rupture. Poruchi et al. Performed a study to assess the outcome of patients older than 75 years of age in whom ruptured aneurysms were treated by clipping surgery. A total of 333 patients were analyzed. Independent predictors of unfavorable outcome were poor grade and ruptured AC aneurysm, but not age of 80 years or older. Advanced age did not represent a risk factor for poor outcome of clipping surgery in elderly patients. In patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage treated by coil embolization, the patients over 80 years of age were more likely to suffer symptomatic vasospasm when compared with the less than 8 years of age, which has significantly correlated with the worse clinical outcome. Ikawa et al. Did a study to clarify the risk factors of treatment for UCA aneurysms in elderly patients more than 65 years of age in Japan. Risk factors for morbidity at discharge were basilar artery aneurysm compared with the ICA aneurysm, diabetes mellitus, antiplatelet drug, and anticoagulation drug. However, highest hospital volume compared with the lowest was an inverse risk factor. Sorensen et al. In their study on UCA aneurysms found that patients with 80 years had a significantly higher incidence of hypertension and a significantly lower incidence of smoking history and a familial aneurysm history. UCAs greater than 7 millimeter carry a non-negligible risk of rupture of 3.2% per patient year. Silva et al. Analyzed the perioperative outcomes of the UCAs in elderly patients more than 65 years old. They found higher prevalence of various comorbidities and the incidence of complications. Clipping patients had perioperative stroke of 10.3%, whereas coiling patients had 3.5%. But this is for the clipping patients had acute renal failure, whereas coiling patients had deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism. So most of these patients have been, for the patients with octogenarians, there are very less studies. Most of the cases are for more than 65 years. And most of the times it is studied for the ruptured aneurysms. So we decided to analyze our experience at Fujita Health University Bantane Hospital. So we did a retrospective study involving all the 33 patients of unruptured cerebral saccular aneurysms operated surgically in elderly patients between 80 and 89 years. We collected the data of all the patients operated between January 2017 and October 2019. Preoperative evaluation, neurological status was evaluated with the Glasgow Coma Score. Investigation with the CT angiogram. Patients underwent surgical clipping or bypass surgery depending on the case. Postoperative neurological status was assessed using Glasgow Coma Score and by the presence or absence of the motor weakness of the limbs. These were the comorbidities found in our patients. Hypertension was the most common comorbidity, which was found in 34% of the cases. Other risk factors like cerebral ischemia, diabetes, atherosclerosis, hyperlipidemia, angina, systemic cancer, degenerative spine diseases, antiplatelet anticoagulation medication, previous aneurysm surgery, family history of subarachnoid hemorrhage, smoking and alcohol. So 31 patients were in the anterior circulation and two aneurysms were in the posterior circulation. Most common aneurysms were ICPC, which accounted for 10 cases, and MC aneurysm accounted for 10 cases. So surgery was planned for all the cases. All the patients underwent preoperative CFD evaluation, intraoperatively MEP monitoring. We used a microscope, endoscope, intraoperative ICG, and intraoperative Doppler. Results of our studies, we operated 33 aneurysms in 27 patients with a mean age group of 82.4 years. 75% of the patients were females, and the mean size of the aneurysm was 6.57. So results, clipping was done in 32 aneurysms. One case of pica aneurysm underwent occipital artery to pica bypass. Complications were noted. Most common complication was a chronic subdural hematoma in 7 patients, all of which underwent aspiration. One patient had extradural hematoma, which underwent craniotomy and evacuation. One patient with meningitis treated conservatively. And transient lower cranial nerve palsy was occurred in a bypass patient, which was recovered in postoperative period. The mean duration of stay was 16.62 days. The result is that all the patients were discharged with the Glasgow Coma Score of 15/15 without motor weakness of the limbs. Age, sex, risk factors, and comorbid diseases did not influence the outcome of UCA sacral aneurysm in octogenarians. So we conclude that though the octogenarians are at a risk for open surgery for aneurysm, unruptured sacral aneurysms have got good result in tertiary care vascular center in Japan. Hence, advanced age alone should not be considered for preferring coiling against clipping. And octogenarians are more prone for developing postoperative chronic subdural hematoma due to the atrophy of the brain. Thank you.
Great, Binoy. Thank you very much for participating.
Thank you.
Any comments or questions from the panelists? Let me get you off the screen share there. Okay, so we can see face. There we go. Okay, there we go. Okay. Okay, no comments or questions from anybody?
Yes, I have. Yeah, I would love.
Go ahead. Let's see who's next. Go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah. We are very, very concerned about this message, because when we see an unruptured aneurysm in 80 years old or more, we send him back home and tell him that there is no way that we are helping him by operating. So this is a change of paradigm, what you are saying, because I think that not only in Italy, but everywhere in the world, 80 years or older patients are not considered for surgery because of statistical epidemiological concern that we are not offering any benefits. So what is your personal opinion on that?
Sir, all these patients are unruptured aneurysms. So all the cases will be having the neurological status as a 15/15 without any deficits. And if they are fit for the surgery, we should definitely give the option of it. That is the reason. There is no much studies on the unruptured aneurysms here. All the studies whichever is done is on the ruptured aneurysms. That's why we analyze the data. So my opinion is, if the patient is fit for the surgery, we should offer them a surgical option also, because in our case, all the cases improved without any deficit. It is individual. We should individualize the patient, and if we feel that patient is fit for the surgery, we should offer the surgical option also.
I know it would be very hard to digest from the rest of the world, but I would like to comment that patients in Japan are very much healthy, and as you know, they are not as frail as people from in other places. On the next day of surgery, they just walk into your consultation room. Okay, next day of surgery. My age is not a criteria. So you'll be really surprised with the kind of health in real they have.
So we should always, I think, we should always individualize the patient. Whichever country the patient is fit for the surgery, we should give them the option of endovascular and surgery also. Because most of the times, patients are not affordable for endovascular coiling. But they are affordable for the cheaper surgery, because surgery costs very less amount. So the results are showing that they have got good results also.
Okay, very good. Okay, let's move on to, thank you very much, Binoy, and I hope you continue to participate. Okay, we're going to start the next presentation. Dr. Satish Kannan is going to be presenting protocol of Fujita Butane Hospital. But before we do that, let's go around to the panel. Satish, we'll be back in a second. Let's introduce everybody one by one. Ricardo, could you please introduce yourself? Are you there, Ricardo?
Introduce yourself.
Go ahead, Ricardo. Please introduce yourself. Go ahead.
Yes, John.
Yeah, please introduce yourself.
Myself. What happened?
Whoop, he left. Okay, go ahead, Gautam. Could you please introduce yourself?
Go, Gautam.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead. Go ahead. Introduce yourself, please.
I'm Dr. Gautam from Bantania Hospital Fellow. I'm doing fellowship here since last 2 months. And I'm a consultant neurosurgeon in Dr. Ela Institute, Chennai.
Okay, welcome.
I think Satish is Satish Kannan.
I think we better move on. Not a smooth production, but it'll work. Okay, welcome, Satish, and it's all yours. Could you please say a few words about yourself, and on to your presentation. Are you muted there, Satish? Let me unmute you if you are. Okay.
What is the time?
Unmute yourself there. Go ahead, Satish.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Satish Kannan from Chennai, India. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. John Bennett and Professor Kato for giving me this opportunity. A big hand to my friends, Dr. Raja and Dr. Gautam. Without much delay, I will go ahead with my presentation. This was a study which I carried out during my fellowship in Fujita. This is basically use of our protocol of multimodality tools in the safe clipping of unruptured anti-circulation aneurysms. So basically, advances in neuroimaging and its widespread use has led to an increase in the diagnosis of unruptured anti-circulation aneurysms, also known as incidental aneurysms. But the management per se is quite controversial. So the UCAS study in Japan showed that apart from the size, location, and shape, there are other factors which are very much important, which are basically, finally they came to a conclusion that the risk for rupture was significantly higher if the aneurysms were 7 mm or larger, or the location was very important, that is if they were in the ACOM or in the ICPC location, or when they had a doctor's act as independent risk factors. So these risk factors predicted that apart from size, location, and the aneurysm morphology also plays a role in their rupture rate. So in our study, we used our protocol basically of using multimodality tools, namely indocyanine green with the DIVA. I will just explain what DIVA is. DIVA is basically dual image video angiography, which is real-time imaging using, and the same dye is used, but the imaging is in real-time so that the anatomy is much clearer when compared to an ICG, which is just a black and white screen. Then we use a neuroendoscope, a 0-degree endoscope, and neuromonitoring MEP is used in all cases, and microdoppler is used in selective cases. So all cases which are anti-circulation aneurysms operated at our institute from 2016 to 18 were taken into account. So basically, we assessed outcome at immediate post-op, at discharge, and at 3 months of follow-up by defining permanent morbidity as drop in MRS by 1 at 3 months follow-up and transient morbidity as temporary deficit which improved at the time of discharge. Post-operative events like seizures, infections, which did not affect or change the pre-operative MRS were excluded. All patients had a minimum 3 months follow-up before outcome conclusion. So this is basically the Fujita-Bantani protocol. So all patients had a pre-operative planning with 4D CTA and CFD as explained by my friend Dr. Gautam. Then after exposure, Sylvian fissure dissection, dissection of the aneurysm is being done. Then routinely an ICG DVAR is done, subsequently followed by an endoscopic evaluation. Then an MEP, baseline MEP is taken up. In certain cases where we are not very clear, we also do a microdoppler evaluation. Subsequently, after clipping, the ICG video angiography DVAR is repeated along with the endoscope and the MEP. If all is fine, the procedure is completed. So this is the CFD which was explained by my friend Dr. Gautam. This is showing that the pressure is very high. The yellow here indicating the pressure is quite high. This is a case of an ACOM aneurysm operated during my period there. And here showing that the wall shear stress is quite low, but the vectors are quite divergent, though not clearly seen in this image. So this is a dual image video angiography image, which is probably one of the most brilliant image to see, where the vessel is very clearly seen along with the all nearby neurovascular structures. Whereas in the case of an ICG, we will not be able to see the nearby neurovascular structures. Thereby, the anatomical correlation is quite much better when we have the DVAR imaging. So here is an illustrative case where figure A shows an aneurysm of the internal carotid artery, then subsequently an ICG image, and subsequently a DVAR image showing the aneurysm with the same dye is used, but the optic nerve and the nearby neurovascular structures are very well seen. This is the advantage of DVAR. And subsequently, after clipping, here we can see the ICG image, and the DVAR image showing the flow is much more clear. And here you can see these vessels, the small perforators are well preserved. And at the same time, we can also see the neurovascular structures here, where the optic nerve is seen, where on this side, the optic nerve is not very clearly seen. So DVAR images per se give better anatomical correlation, which are clearly depicted in this image. So this is the 0-degree endoscope, which we routinely used at our Fujita Bantani Hospital. So the second case is again an illustrative one of an ICPC aneurysm, where after exposure, the aneurysm is seen. This is the DVAR image. Whereas the routine microscopic image, we are not able to see this perforator. But when you use the endoscope, this perforator is well seen. This helps in planning for this surgical clipping. Now here, the clipping is performed under microscope. Then here again, the clipping, the routine DVAR verification is done. But here, we use the endoscopic to confirm that the clip is not included the perforator, thereby preserving the perforator, which is a very vital step. So endoscopic view is showing that the ECOM is preserved with complete obliteration of the aneurysm. So this, I think, which is very important adjunct using the endoscope, thereby we can be very sure that we have not clipped a small perforator, a small, very so-called not very important perforator. But in this case, we can see it's well preserved. Another thing is that when this is done, and all these patients are basically unruptured patients who come walking to the OPD. So it's very important that they walk out with no morbidities or any sequelae. So this is the demographic data of the last 3 years with MCA being the most common, subsequently followed by the ACOM. So this is the year-wise summary. In 2016, a total of 98 cases were operated, majority being MCA followed by ICPC. There was a drop in MEP in one case with no symptoms, and seizures in one case post-operatively. There was a drop in MEP in a case of ICPC, with the patient had a transient hemiparesis, which improved at the time of discharge. And there's a transient third nerve palsy in one case. This was the 2017 data, where a total of 119 cases were operated, again MCA being the most common, followed by ICPC. This was the 2018 data, where a total of 130 cases were operated, which again MCA being the most common, followed by ICPC and IC ophthalmic. Seizures were seen in the post-operative period in 3 cases. Transient aphasia was seen in ICA case. So in total, the 2016, a total of 98 cases were operated, with female sex being the most common. Most common was an MCA aneurysm followed by ICPC. The mean size was 4.8 with no morbidity, or mortality or permanent morbidity. Only transient morbidity was seen in two cases, that is 2.4%. Again, in 2017, a total of 118 cases were operated with MCA1 being the most common. The mean size was 6 mm with no morbidity or mortality. In 2018, a total of 130 cases were operated with MCA being the most common. The mean size 5.1 with no mortality or permanent morbidity, only in transient morbidity in 0.7%. So this is the total summary. So from 2016 to 2018, a total of 347 cases were operated with a transient morbidity of 0.9% with nil permanent morbidity and nil mortality. So summarizing, the mean size was 5.3 in all these cases. There was no mortality or morbidity, only transient morbidity in 0.9% of the cases. So during the initial part of the study, MEP monitoring was done on a selective basis. Subsequently, as the protocol evolved, we have used it in all the cases as mentioned above. Now it has become a routine for all cases. All cases had suture removal done on the 7th postoperative day, and the average hospital stay was 12 to 14 days. So the goal of aneurysm surgery is to achieve satisfactory clipping such that there is no residual filling of the aneurysm. At the same time, without distal branch or perforated occlusion or parent vessel stenosis. As aneurysm remnants have the potential for regrowth and hemorrhage, whereas clip occlusion of the parent artery or small hidden perforators can lead to permanent devastating neurological deficits. Thus, preserving flow in these branches and perforators of the parent artery is of very important for a successful aneurysm surgery. So we believe our protocol, which has evolved over a short period of time, provides all the vital information to the operating surgeon, thereby aiding in quicker and better decision-making to make microneurosurgical clipping safe, thus consistently resulting in satisfactory operative outcomes and achieving the goal of aneurysm surgery. So in our center, for most unruptured anti-circulation aneurysms, microsurgical clipping is a treatment of choice. We believe our protocol of intraoperative usage of multimodality tools have aided in the safe microsurgical clipping and has consistently resulted in good operative outcomes. So we recommend our Fujitop Brantani protocol in all cases of microsurgical clippings to consistently achieve good operative outcomes. So this was me during my fellowship assisting Professor Kato. This was me again with Professor Kato and Professor Takizawa. The same paper was published in the AJNS for further references. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Satish. Excellent presentation. Comments or questions from? Let me get you off the screen share there, Satish. Hold on. Okay. There you go. Okay. Any questions or comments from the panelists?
I have a comment.
Go ahead.
Yes, Professor.
Satish, we are very in agreement with you when you talk about controlling the perforators with the ICG and the DIVA methodology, but I'm very concerned about what we see when we see ICG for remnants of aneurysm, because sometimes the aneurysm is black, but if you wait or you move the sac, you can see some filling. And we have the use of puncturing the sac. That is very, very clear method to say if it is closed or not the aneurysm. Because sometimes I guess that ICG is not so reliable in this option. I mean, for perforators is fantastic, but for aneurysm,
sure,
is not that much. What is your opinion about it?
Professor, I agree the same, because they routinely use micro Doppler in cases where they are not very clearly able to see the perforators. But in the case of occlusion, I think they go just by the ICG and DIVA. I think we are left with very few options. And I've never, in this study, I've never seen them open up aneurysms and confirming whether there is not any flow.
Hello.
Go ahead, Gautam.
I'm Dr. Gautam. I have a comment on this.
Go ahead.
Regarding what the question by Dr. Paveji, I have been going through the histopathology of the aneurysmal wall, and I have been finding that most of the aneurysm wall receive blood supply, vasovasorum is dilated in these aneurysms. So the ICG which you see in the later part or after most of the time, if you see though the aneurysm sac is black and then finally enhancing, maybe because of the blood supply to the sac from the outside. So probably this is what my observation when I'm going through the aneurysm wall. There is a wall increase in the size of the wall even after clipping in some aneurysms. So the I think this is one of the factors which will give a pseudo effect of the ICG in late stages.